Shalom, greetings to all and all. Selamta, Inest Lin. This is Ras Alonso Tafar reporting for the Lion of the Tribe of Judah Society of His Imperial Majesty, Haile Selassie I, and His Christ Jesus, HaMashiach, Yeshua. For the record, this day is Sunday, May 28th, and 2017, and it is 11:35 a.m. Now the following work that we are to present, we do or we bring forth on the basis that to do what we can is to do what we must. If ones can perform it better, then by all means, feel free to do so. Now, a few key points, disclaimers, not really, but you know, something of that nature. The following text that we are to read, we must make mention that the names in Amharic, the Amharic names, the pronunciation of them cannot be assured that we will do it as accurately as it would have been possible if the names would have been provided for in the Amharic text or in the Amharic language. That is, we do not know the vowel system, the pointing on the vowel system that is utilized, which includes the English alphabet. And so we are sure that the pronunciation of Amharic names will not be precise and exact. So let this be a warning to the listener. And to continue, we make mention that we are not professional readers. As a matter of fact, we did not begin to read up until the age of possibly 25, and we are now 30, and that is because we were called to Rastafari. We were called to Christ in light of Rastafari. Until that time, we had no interest in reading. To add to this, we learned to speak and speak mostly Spanish our whole lives to this very day. Therefore, you know, if ones could do it better, by all means, bring it forth. And I just do what we can, and that is to do what we must. Chapter 44, Our Journey from Corram to the War Front at Mechu. While we were at Corram, enemy aircraft would come over daily, making repeated turns to and fro from 2 to 9 o'clock, that is to say 8 a.m. to 3 p.m., dropping many bombs and much poison gas and causing harm to our army. The army officers who had taken the offensive on the Tambien front had fought there with valor and discharged their duty. In the end, they were defeated by the superiority of bombs and weapons and had dispersed. We then sent for them to join us. They reached Corram on 10th Megavit, 19th March 1936, at 8 o'clock at night, that is to say 2 a.m., and were reunited with us. While the principals were His Highness Raskasa Hailu and His Highness Rasayu Mangesha, with them were Dejesmachu Mangesha Yelma, Dejesmachu Wont Bewasen Kasa, Dejesmachu Avera Kasa, Sehafe, Tezas Afawerk, Pejeron Lat Iyebalu, Gebre, Asnasmach, Dachne Weltemariam, Fitara Rizaudu Abakoram, and other officers. On Thursday, 11th Megabit, that's to say 20th March 1936, we heard that the Italians had passed Amba Alige and were encamped at Mechu. We decided, therefore, to take the guard of honor which had been waiting with us as rear guard, as well as the army which had returned from the front, and to go to fight with ourselves as leader. We thus set out from Corran at 2 o'clock in the evening, that is to say 8 p.m., and proceeded towards the war front at Hayo. As the night was dark, we directed the army to prepare torches, and we marched by torchlight, and since the road was narrow, the march took many hours. Having marched in this fashion, we spent the day of Megabit 12, which is to say 21st March, at a place a little beyond Lake Ashange, which was suitable for protection against airplanes. And marching again that night, we reached the district called Hayo, or Aya. On this day, enemy aircraft dropped many bombs and were spraying Yeparit poison that was flowing like water. Thus, the terrible death that came upon man and beast was most distressing. The day of 13th megabit, that is to say 22nd March, we spent encamped at Hayo, upon an arid amba, a place that was suitable for observation of aircraft. At 2 o'clock in the evening, which is 8 p.m., we assembled all the army officers and chiefs and explained to them our plan as regards the battle tactics and the order of muster. After this, we directed them, on their part, to express their views in what manner the waging of the battle might be improved. The great officers present on this occasion were His Highness Ras Kasa, His Highness Rasiyum, Ras Getachew, Dejesmach Wandirat, Dejesmach Welde Amanuel, Dejesmach Adafersel, Legeba Tesau, Fitaurari Ashanafi, as well as other captains and army officers who served under them. The officers consulted and then presented to us the following unanimous opinion. Death is an inheritance that cannot fail to come to all of us. God has assigned to us the day, and if we are victorious, then we shall have saved our independence, and if we die, then it will be for our country, for our death will be reckoned as martyrdom. It is a great good fortune to die having struggled with the enemy, making the approach to battle overnight. Let us meet the enemy at dawn. After we had listened to their speech, we said to them, whether we die or live, it is for our country. All we are concerned about is lest our country should die. We then informed them that we would be marching towards the war front to Betawayo. We spent the day of Megabit 14th, that is to say 23rd March, on the arid Amba of Hayo. On this day, the chiefs of Techarchar came with rifles and ammunition, which they had received from the Italians, and expressed to us the following sentiments of loyalty. It is because the Italians had told us, your king is not there, that our hearts were divided. But now that we have seen you with our own eyes, we shall die fighting for our country's freedom with the arms we received from the enemy. And we warned them, saying, do realize that the lies which the enemy is telling you are apt to destroy you and your country. When it was 12 o'clock, that's to say 6 p.m., on this day, we departed from the barren Amba and marched through the night. We camped at Betawayo Cave. This place is vis-a-vis the Italian encampment. When we were at Betawayo on 15th megabit, that is to say 24th March, enemy aircraft spent the day going to and fro and dropping many bombs. At 6 o'clock, which is 12 noon, a large airplane arrived and, flying low over the place where we were, dropped the bombs. From our side, a machine gun volley was fired and it was hit and set on fire. Emitting smoke, it fell beyond the Dubar Pass. The Italian radio confirmed that the plane was burnt together with its crew of four. We stayed at Betawayo, preparing military plans from the 16th to the 19th megabit, which is to say 25th to 28th March. On these days, enemy aircraft went to and fro in great numbers and dropped bombs and poison gas every day as a result of our soldiers' fire. These planes were seen to be burning and to emit smoke going towards the Techarchar lowland. On 19th megabit in particular, one of the aircraft that had come over was hit by an Oerlikon gun and came down near there. After that, many aircraft arrived dropping bombs and poison, and as a result, many people were killed and injured. On Saturday 19th megabit, that is to say 28th March, we summoned the army commanders and gave them the following guidelines. It is necessary to be resolute and to eschew vengeance even when going to hunt a wild beast, let alone for this present decisive great battle against our enemy. Young men facing war, you have seen that God has condemned any irresolute soldier in the past, for it is worthless doing things only on instructions and orders, fearing that God will condemn one, rather than doing one's duty wholeheartedly. If one flees, not having acted resolutely, there is only death. Fight fiercely, lest the freedom of your country of Ethiopia and its flag should be obliterated and torn to shreds. For it is to him who acts decisively and intrepidly that God extends his help. If you break the oath, death is surely bound to occur. Do not die having ruined the honor of your soul and your body. To claim my officer has fled or has died, I have to carry an injured body, is not really motivated by compassion for the injured, but to fabricate a refuge for his frightened heart. When an officer dies, is not a soldier who has been fighting bravely to become an officer? If God favors us, do not hasten to quarrel over property, for Ethiopia's existence is our property and wealth. If you find a foreigner, a wounded prisoner, do not finish him off with the dagger, pistol, or explosives in hand, except if he tries to harm you, for having him as a prisoner may help us to find out the enemy's secrets. If a servant gets separated from his master, troops from their commander, this means the beginning of flight, so recognize it as the enemy of myself and of Ethiopia. Anxious that no harm should befall the rest of our army for lack of precautions, we transmitted to them the orders set out here below and divided into 8 paragraphs. 1. It is at 2 o'clock in the evening, that is 8 p.m., that you are to depart from your camp to the place to which you have been ordered. 2. When you march at night to go to the battlefront, you are to follow the way which your officer will show you, but you must not. 4. We have to be dedicated to destroying completely the enemy who has now invaded us, as he has set out to extinguish altogether Ethiopia and her people, by killing just one man before the battle ends and going back exhibiting him as a war trophy before the enemy's defeat is known, is bound to hamper our war effort. For if you return and say, "For me alone, things have gone well," you are leaving your friend on his own and exposing him to enemy attack. Thus, the trophy will not be counted in your favor if you return in the morning claiming that you have been successful. 5. Since the Ethiopian people, the chief possessions is freedom, do not hasten to pillage things before you have defeated and put to flight the invading enemy who has come to destroy that freedom and before you have caused him to abandon his position. If you plunder him and he then takes it back, what benefit will you have derived? A man who takes away the enemy's property in order to ensure for himself the permanence of the possessions he has taken has first of all to destroy the enemy to prevent him returning and snatching things back. 6. Having spent the day fighting, and if, perhaps, on one occasion, you did not manage to win because the enemy has been too strong for you, you have to fight fiercely until we send you support troops, but you are not to turn back until you are told to withdraw. 7. A rocket signal will be given on Ademoshash to indicate upon open fire. 8. Especially when men of rank are found, they are to be taken prisoners, to the extent that if possible for you, since it is through the evidence of prisoners that enemy secrets and strength are found out, except, of course, if the enemy threatens you with pistol, hand grenade, or dagger. 19th Megabit, 1928, that is to say 28th March, 1936. Afterwards, we divided the strategic order by which we were going into battle into 4 groups, and adding the troops collected from various offices, we arranged that one group be directly commanded and led by ourselves, and that the remaining 3 groups be led by 3 commanders, i.e. His Highness Ras Kassa, by His Highness Rasayum, and by Ras Getachew. The part commanded and led by ourselves direct was divided as follows. At the front, the corps of the Guard of Honor under Gasnasmach Mekuria Bent Yergu and his deputy Grasmach Kefle Ergatu. On the left, the corps of the Guard of Honor under Grasmach Aberakezau. On the right, the corps of palace servants and footmen under Gasnasmach Balhub Dagafu. At the rear, the corps of palace guards under Dejasmach Adafersau. We directed them to be placed in battle position. The 3 groups led by their respective commanders were divided as follows. We divided in the following manner. The men mustered on the central front under the command of His Highness Raskasa Hailu. Raskebeta Mengasha, with his men, the Mahal Safari Corps commanded by Ligaba Tesau Walalu, the army of the Ministry of the Palace commanded by Fetaurari Ashanafi, the army of Baso and Gola commanded by Dejasmanche Gezao Jima, the army of the Ministry of Agriculture, Dejasmanche Abrat Etla, attached as direction guide since he was a native of the district and governor of Mechu. On the right wing, we divided in the following manner the men mustered on the right wing from under the command of His Highness Rasiyu Mengesha, the corps of Schneider rifle carriers, the army of Walago Arjo and Walago Gudru, the cavalry, the contingent of Lika Makwas Haila Mariam Welde Gabriel, the artillery corps commanded by Kaznasmach Welde Johannes Welde Ab, Fetaurarit Ferrit Etla, attached as direction guide since he was a native of the district. On the left wing, we divided in the following manner the men mustered on the left wing from under the command of Rasgetacho Abata, the army of Kambata, the army of the treasury and stores, the army of the Ministry of Finance, the army of the post and telephone ministry commanded by Kaznasmach Tekle Marcos Welde Gabriel, the excellent rifle bearers commanded by Kaznasmach Abeba Rade, the army of the master of the horse commanded by Kaznasmach Bayana Balaina, Dejasmach Hailu Kebeta, attached as direction guide. Other than these, the spiritual fathers who had followed us to help with prayer and supplication, Abuna Petros, Bishop of Walu, Itchage Gebre Georgis, Lik'e Gebre Christos, and Lik'e Likawanit Gebre Ab, we arranged that they be mustered together with their retinue of priests, with the group where we were. Among princes and nobles, the following were assigned to be close to us for consultation and the transaction of essential major affairs: His Highness Raskasa Hailu, His Highness Rasiyum Fitaurari Beru Welde Gabriel, Dejasmach Winderat, Dejasmach Wand Bawasankasa, Dejasmach Abrakasa, and Ato Welde Georges Welde Johannes. After we had arranged that the organization of the battle order and the strategy of approach be conducted in this manner, a sign was given to our army that would serve to distinguish our side from the enemy forces during the battle and in the course of communications. The password was that when someone said, "To whom do you belong?" the person questioned was to reply to him, "To Abat Ekel." If he asked him, "What does Ekel mean?" he could not be trusted to be in my army. He was to say, "The power is God's." If the person questioned replied to him with this password, he could believe him to be of our side. But if it was impossible for him to reply thus, then he would know that he belonged to the enemy army, and he was to regard him with hostility. Besides, we issued a precautionary password to the guard officers who had been ordered to look after the arms and ammunition, equipment and property which remained in the Bitawayo cave. If perchance our army should be defeated, have the arms and equipment set on fire, lest they should fall into enemy hands. As soon as we send you the sign, this message is, our God has not departed from us. Chapter 45, The Battle of Mechu. While we were at the Bitawayo camp on Sunday, 20th Megabit 1928, that is to say 29th March 1936, enemy aircraft coming and going continuously spent the day dropping bombs and poison gas. We gave orders for the battle to begin on the next day, Monday, and we set out from Bitawayo on Sunday at 11 o'clock, which is 5 p.m., to approach more closely to the place of the engagement. We spent the night at Mahan. On Monday, 21st Megabit, that is to say 30th March, as the army which had been grouped into its various contingents was not yet fully assembled, the joining of battle could not take place on the Monday, and we arranged spending the day at Mahan. At this place, there was no cave adequate for protection against attacks from the air. When they told us, having found a small cave, that we should go there and that the cave was insufficient for the whole army, I said to them, I won't go there leaving my people, for just as I have shared joy with my people, so I shall inseparably share its tribulations, so I remained there. We had determined that the battle be waged on Tuesday, 22nd Megabit, which is 31st March, on the preceding day, on the basis of the prepared plan. We had given orders that the mustered ranks in their various contingents should march that night and get close to the battle area, and that the fighting should start at dawn, when the army, in its respective divisions, marched off in accordance with its orders and reached its destination, close to the front. It spent the night there. We ourselves set out from Mahan at 10 o'clock at night, which is 4 a.m., and marched towards the battlefield. Our advanced troops were marching in the hours of darkness with the intention of approaching the enemy's fortified positions when the enemy's night patrols sounded the noise of fire in order to wake up their side. Our army, while still on the march, began shooting in the direction in which the sound of firing had been heard. They thus started shooting at a place called Mahan in the Mechel area, where the Italian soldiers were firmly entrenched in fortified positions, and since the fighting had been opened by an accidental shot prior to the plan which we had devised, we gave orders for the regular battle to begin. And so the fighting started to develop. As our army moved forward with enthusiasm and reached the enemy's fortifications, the enemy troops abandoned the forward positions and were seen to defend a second, more heavily fortified line towards the rear. Within 4 or 5 hours, enemy aircraft arrived, dropped bombs, and cut off our army at the rear, preventing it from coming to the aid of the advanced troops at the front. At this time, the enemy army was recovering once again and began fighting hard to re-enter the strongholds which it had abandoned. Our forces spent the whole day fighting with an ardent spirit and with daring. The battle did not cease until 5 o'clock at night, that is 11 p.m. In this day's fighting, many nobles and army officers died, sacrificing their lives for their country. While we ourselves were in this kind of struggle, and as it became evening, we returned to Mahan, where we had spent the night yesterday. Since our army had greatly suffered in the fighting, most of them marched that night to Betawayo and rested there. Some troops spent the night near the enemy's fortified lines and kept up a running fire throughout the night. Wednesday, 23rd Megabit, 1st April, we spent the day at the Mahan and gave orders for the wounded to be carried in and the dead to be buried. Some of the troops, their ardor having been aroused, went to the enemy trenches and spent the day fighting there. The day of Thursday, 24th Megabit, 2nd April, we again spent at Mahan, when on this day we informed the army officers of our intention of having the battle renewed. All those who had assessed the situation remarked to us as follows. Since our army marched from Tuesday evening till today to the Betawayo camp, we are now very few who are present here. We do not have enough troops for a battle. The place where we are now is a dangerous one, because there is nothing at all here that represents protective cover against airplanes. For this reason, we went to Betawayo. It would be better if we fought once we had reassembled and remobilized the army. We replied to them, if we pull out our foothold from here, the renewal of the battle will not take place. Hence, it is preferable for us here to fight. At this time, His Highness Rascasa and His Highness Rasayung were uneasy at our decision and said, to fight before there are insufficient troops for the battle means dying and perishing in vain. Since they persuaded us by detailing all the reasons, we left for Betawayo at 6 o'clock at night, that is midnight, following the counsel which the army officers had preferred to us. We spent the day of Friday, 25th Megabit, that is 3rd April, at the Betawayo cave. While we were there, it was learned that the Italians had reoccupied the fortified positions which they had abandoned last Tuesday. In consequence of this, we directed that an army contingent guarding the mountain passes be stationed at the places said to be suitable for defending the surroundings of Betawayo, so as to enable us to resist the invading enemy. We then proceeded to devise military plans for the future in consultation with the army commanders. The places referred to are the other mountain passes at the central camp of Betawayo, where we were, and the following are the army commanders who were ordered there for guard duty. First, Dejasmach Hailu Cabeda, with the army of Sakota, to be stationed at the pass between Bokra and Mahan Mountains. Two, Rasget Acho, at the three passes which are situated between the mountain barrier of Hayo and Atbamazu. Three, from the cave at the rear of the mountain barrier of Hayu up to Mahan, Ras Kebeda Mengesha. 4. It was arranged that the contingent of the palace ministry should be encamped at the mountain pass near Hayo Mikael. Before the army officers, whom we had detailed to guard duties at the passes, could reach the places and occupy the passes, the enemy army had come out from its trenches and was seen to enter Mahan, where we had rested on the previous day. The place called Mahan is near to Betawayo, where we were now. We had observed the initial stages of the enemy's march, and since he had emerged from his fortified positions, it seemed possible to engage him on the plains, particularly as it was bound to be the beginning of a march towards us. We therefore transmitted orders to the various commanders, take up positions for immediate running fire in order to fight from those positions. As the enemy aircraft were going to and fro, they hit our camp uninterruptedly, and we ourselves, not excepted, were resisting by firing the Orlikon. The enemy army, which had entered Mahan, had abandoned an engagement on the plains or an advance towards us, and was engaged in constructing fortifications there. Then, firing its guns, it began to hit our soldiers' camp with long-range artillery. At this time, our troops were fed up, as they had suffered much injury from the bombs and poison gas which the aircraft above were raining upon them, as well as from the firing of guns below. Thus, the army began to dissolve and turned round to march towards Koram. Because in this manner, our entire plan, which we had conceived to fight at Betawayo, had come to grief, the nobles and army commanders approached us and preferred to us the following opinion. It would be better if we fought at Ashange after returning to Koram and assembling the army there. If we failed to succeed there, it would be preferable if we fought taking up position in Lasta, in Yaju, or in Wayu. After this, we desired that all the army commanders should assemble and reflect about this. All of them, therefore, congregated in front of us and expressed their counsel in detail. They assured us on oath that the advice which they had offered sprang from a true conscience. We cautioned them in these terms: since man is God's tool, and lest I should say that what you have told me is fraudulent, you have assured me on oath that it is absolutely firm. I shall therefore go as far as Alamata, but pray to God and, while suppressing mutual rivalry, reflect on our sins, arouse your servants and your retinue, and think what it is that you are dying for, rather than being concerned over living. After this, we directed that the provisions and arms which were at the Betawayo should be distributed to the army officers, and we gave orders that the remaining weapons and supplies should be set on fire, lest they be of service to the enemy. We then departed from Koram at 3:30 o'clock at night, which is 9:30 p.m. When we reached Ashange in the morning of Saturday 26th Megabit, which is to say 4th April, enemy airplanes came in great numbers and hit with bombs our army marching at Ashange. We ourselves left Lake Ashange on the left and spent the day near Ashange Mariam, which is in the direction towards the right. And that evening we marched on and spent the night at Enda Agafari. Sunday, the 27th Megabit, that is 5th April, we stayed the day at the Enda Agafari. On this day, the Italians had sent the army, which they had at Corbata, down in the Chetchar lowlands in order to encircle the Ashangi regions where we had spent the night. We had heard that their army, reaching Korram and Alamata before ours, had occupied the place. Our army, which was marching along there, suffered heavy losses as it was hit by Italian airplanes and by worthless country folk launching attacks upon it. Those who survived scattered and proceeded by way of Lasta. It became thus impossible for us to carry out our plan to fight.
Chapter 46. Our return to Addis Ababa. Our army, which had advised that we should fight at Korram and had taken an oath to this effect, was beginning to disperse, claiming they had been told to go on the road to Lasta. They proceeded on their march with mutual recriminations. The chiefs who had remained with us observed the condition of the army and remarked to us that it would be better to retreat to the area behind us and to fight in Lasta or Yaju. However, as we were convinced that it was not a useful enterprise to do things on our own without an army, we departed from Edda Agafari on Sunday 27th Megabit, that is 5th April 1936, at 12 o'clock, that is to say 6 p.m., marched through that night and then rested at Lat Georgis at a cave called Gureza. We spent the day of Monday 28th Megabit, that is 6th April, at Lat Georgis, and then marched at 12 o'clock, which is 6 p.m., to Gura Mariam. There we remained during the day of 29th Megabit, that is 7th April, and departed at 11 o'clock, which is 5 p.m., resting at Marua at a place called Mariam Mahader. On Wednesday 30th Megabit, that is 8th April, we stayed at Mahadar during the day and left for Azazge at 10 o'clock, which is 4 p.m. There we remained a little, and at 6:30, which is 12:30, we continued the march, reached Lasta, Gerarich, and rested there. On Saturday, 3rd Miyazia, that is 11th April, we crossed the Tekazi, and when we had arrived at Telasfare Selassie, we spent the night at church to celebrate the festival of the resurrection, Easter, which is Fasica, Pesach. On Sunday, 4th Miyazia, 12th April, we spent the day at Telasfare Selassie on account of the Easter festival and also remained there overnight. As prior to this day, the army, which was on the move, had marched onwards, a journey of 3 or 4 days. We transmitted the following order with the intentions that no harm should befall either those who had gone ahead or those who had remained behind. May it reach your officers and troops who have advanced ahead. The fact that you have gone ahead and got separated from us has caused harm, and therefore, as soon as this message reaches you, you are to stop and wait at the various places at which you are encamped. If, however, you proceed further after this order has reached you, you will be in the position of enemies towards me and my government. After this message had been received, Rasget Acheu and Legaba Tesau stopped and waited in a district called Gemwasha, but other chiefs and troops, having gone ahead, lost many men when the country people attacked them. On 5th Miyazia, 13th April, at 9 o'clock, which is 3 o'clock, we set out from Telasfare Selassie and marched to the churches at Holy Lalibela. Among the great notables in our retinue were Abuna Petros and its Chagikepre Georgis, His Highness Raskasa Hailu, Dejesmach Wand Bewasan Kasa, Dejesmach Abra Kasa, Dejesmach Welde Amanuel Hawas, and Dejesmach Adafersau Yenadu. On this day, at 4 o'clock in the evening, that is 10 p.m., we reached Lalibela and stayed the night in the house of His Highness Raskasa. At 10 o'clock during the night, which is 4 a.m., we went to Beta Meriam Church and had Mass celebrated there. On Tuesday, 6th Miyazia, which is 14th April, we toured and visited all the churches of Holy Lalibela. On this day, the American missionaries who were at Lalibela received us and offered us hospitality. Subsequently, we went out to visit Ashantan Mariam Later, we returned and again spent the night at Ras Casa's house. On 7th Miyazia, which is 15th April, at 8 o'clock at night, which is 2 a.m., we departed and began our march. In the morning, we paid homage from afar to the Church of Holy Naakweto Laab, and then passed on to Genet Amariam. When we arrived there, the priest of Genet Amariam said the Nesebho prayer, which is the Magnificat, and received us with songs. Subsequently, we returned to Telasfarre, and arriving there at 6 o'clock, which is noon, we spent the night there. As we had previously heard of some clashes occurring between the army on the march and the country people, we issued the following proclamation so that troops as well as peasants should stop the quarrel amongst themselves and concentrate only on resisting the enemy. Proclamation: The Lion of Judah hath prevailed. Haile Selassie I, elect of God, King of Kings of Ethiopia. Men of my country Ethiopia, while we are stationed at one place only, together with our army, our enemy has come upon us not only on one side but distributed over some 8 directions. The fighting and mutual enmity between peasants and soldiers has become a source of great harm to our country and to our people, as our attacker has been striving to destroy Ethiopia's independence, setting fire to churches, uprooting inherited land, and debasing our religion. We have sent an army to Tambien and Makale, and we ourselves, having been toiling, entering into the slaughter to the extent that God has enabled us. But because it is only by fighting for many days that we shall be able to repulse our enemies' might, and because we have become convinced that by staying in one place for a long time, soldiers and peasants get into mutual hostile positions and fights on account of looting, which are injurious to our people, we are now marching towards Shoa to wage the great battle in a province in which there are ample supplies. Do not believe it to be the truth when the enemy who has now invaded us distributes to you some pamphlets making his message appear agreeable. You have heard with your own ear and seen with your own eye the violence and iniquity he is now committing even upon our churches, priests, monks, and women, as he has come against us determined to extinguish our descendants and to pass our inheritance to his son. It is well known how even a thorn, let alone a human being endowed with intelligence, can cause trouble by hurting him who stumbles upon it at its habitat. So when he enters your land, attack him who camps or marches upon it with all the means at your command. Go about your land and fight wherever you are, lest your country and your land be violated. But if it causes you difficulty to work while remaining on your land, then come to where we are, and we shall give you your livelihood for yourself and for your dependents. So fight in company with us for your country, your inherited land, and for your religion, since our enemy has risen up to extinguish Ethiopia's future generation, whether rich or poor. He assembles the people in whichever district he enters, only to exterminate them with machine guns. You will be convinced of this if you ask what happened in Tambien and Adwa. Even the gentry who submitted to his command, he arrested and carried away without any wrongdoing, whatever being found against them. Therefore, whether you fight or you do not fight, death is bound to come to you. That I tell you this is not to my advantage or to deceive you. It is, in fact, for your own benefit, as I know for sure that afterwards there will catch up with you your contrition that cannot be forgotten and loss that cannot be made good. Believe what I tell you without doubting it, for I have made God the witness that I make known to you that which I know myself. 5th Miyazia, 1928, 13th April 1936, written at Telasfarre in Lasta. Subsequently, we transmitted the following written orders, in particular to the army marching with us. As it is necessary to observe caution on the journey henceforth, I shall appoint an officer for you who have none, so march without getting separated from him. You who have an officer, see that you are not separated from him during the march. On the march, 2/3 should join the escorts, 1/3 to join the camp followers. When you are on the march, keep your baggage in the center. You are to march without leaving your path, taking great care and being in front and at the rear, left and right. If you remain behind the rear guard, or if you pass ahead of the fitaurari, you will be punished. If you are the commander of a marching column, obtain your papers in turn and proceed observing the order you have been assigned, without advancing ahead or staying behind. Ammunition is for you to fight with and is not for you to use for marketing, hence do not sell it. 5th Miazia, 1928, that is 13th April 1936, written at Telasferre. Since our army had turned back in disarray, it was clearly a useless matter for us alone to carry on the work together with a few of our men. The plan which we had conceived, i.e. of going ahead to Yaju, taking a position there and to fight, had remained unfulfilled. Similarly, all the places which we had intended to be used for fighting had been occupied by the enemy who had got there first, and therefore we had to march being conducted along directions and routes which we had not intended to take. In the districts which we had to traverse, we certainly encountered things which were troublesome for our convoy. The districts through which we passed on our way from Mecheu to Addis Ababa were Sakota, Lasta, Welde, Delanta, Warehemenu, Tanta, Alibet, Abaibet, Lagamba, Lagahida, Jama, Mida, Mahabete, Salale, and Feche. We passed all these and entered Addis Ababa at 3 o'clock, which is 9 a.m. on Thursday, 22nd Miazia, 1928, which is 30th April, 1936. Chapter 47, The Decision on Advice to Go Abroad. On Thursday, 22nd Miazia, that is 30th April, after we had re-entered our capital city, Addis Ababa, the ministers and nobles and all the great men assembled in our palace, and an important council was held. At the council, it was decided, on the basis of advice proffered, that it would be well for the emperor to go to Europe and to inform the League of Nations, by his own voice, of all the violence Italy had perpetrated against us. Hence, it was only necessary for us to choose one of two courses of action and to take a decision. The first was to cease fighting and to go to Geneva to alert the League of Nations, as had been resolved by the council. The second was to go on fighting with the few soldiers available in the city, irrespective of the death of the aged and of the women and children, or indeed of the burning of the capital. While we were still pondering this difficult thought, the news that reached us hourly was to the effect that the Italians were to set the city on fire with bombs, taking the emperor's re-entry into Addis Ababa as a pretext. Furthermore, lest we should fail to believe that the Italians would destroy the city of Addis Ababa with bombs, it ought to be mentioned that we had heard that they had hit with bombs the town of Harar, in which there was no army and no defense equipment, and that they had caused much damage to the Mons. Andreas Jaroseo, who lived greatly honored within the walled city. As it was in this city of Harar that we had spent most of our time since our childhood, the fact of its being hit by bombs and set on fire saddened our heart very specially. Hence, we were convinced that there was nothing at all that would prevent an enemy who had set the city of Harar on fire doing the same to Addis Ababa. Moreover, meaning to make quite sure about this, they had dropped from airplanes printed pronouncements together with black flags that they would destroy the city. In particular, when we were contemplating fighting at Addis Ababa, there appeared, depicted before our eyes, our soldiers on the northern front, numbering many thousands, who were grievously injured and were dying, burnt by poison gas on the mountains and in the plains. And in addition, there was the suffering of the country people, women and children, who had perished, being burnt with poison gas. It was thus an extremely hard thing for us to decide whether on our account an attack of similarly grievous affliction would be made on Addis Ababa. The men who attended the council loved their country and were loyal to us and thus spoke to us as follows. We now know that we are unable to win fighting with the Italians either at Addis Ababa or outside. For what purpose do we exterminate our peaceful people and have its capital burnt by bombs? Hence, as previously planned, let the government move to Gor and let Bitwadad-Wadid-Tzadik stay here acting as regent. But it would be better if the emperor, accompanied by the necessary assistance, presented his appeal. Since they had resolved thus, we accepted their advice. We subsequently issued orders that Bitwadad-Wadid-Tzadik should conduct all government business from Gor. We also gave instructions that the Kantiba in command of the municipal guards should have security safeguarded, and when the Italians reached the outskirts of Addis Ababa, he was to receive them peacefully with the customary white flag. Afterwards, we boarded the train and went down to Diradawa during the night of Friday to Saturday. When we reached Diradawa in the evening of Saturday 24th Miyazia, that is 2nd May, we heard that panic had broken out at Addis Ababa, that many people had died, that much property had been looted, and that many houses had been set on fire. As to the cause of the rioting that had occurred, we learnt from the newspaper, after passing through Djibouti, that the Italians had spread the exceedingly shameful and despicable falsehood that it was the departing emperor who had given instructions that the city be set on fire and property be looted. While we were thinking only of preventing the death at the hands of the enemy of those who were our people, how could we contemplate that by our own advice they should exterminate and plunder each other? Furthermore, if we had such a thought, how could we have gone away, leaving to the Italians the new palace which we had built at great expense, without setting it on fire? When we set out on this our journey, we took down Ras Khailu as far as Diradawa. He had been found guilty and was under arrest ever since he had attempted earlier on in 1924, which is 1932, to create unrest in Ethiopia by deceitfully conspiring with the enemy who had now come to destroy our independence. Evidence had been given against him, and he was condemned to imprisonment for life. Although he deserved to die for betraying Ethiopia, his country, we released him and set him free, thinking that God should mete out to him what was due for his betrayal. He himself had confessed all the wrongdoing he had committed in the past and had given his word on oath to safeguard Ethiopia's freedom, working for it in future to the utmost extent possible. He then returned to Addis Ababa. We set out for Diradawa by train and reached Djibouti on Sunday 25th Miyazia, 3rd May, at 4:30 in the morning, which is 10:30 a.m. We shall never forget the welcome of friendship which the governor of the colony, other French government authorities, and the whole population accorded to us. It was at Government House that preparations for resting had been made for us, and we went there together with our family. When at this hour filled with sorrow, we saw the friendly reception given to us, without anything missing, exactly as on several previous occasions when we had gone there to Djibouti. We can only say that our heart was greatly encouraged.
Chapter 48, From Djibouti to Jerusalem. The plan upon which we were resolved when we departed from Addis Ababa had been for us to go to Geneva and to draw the attention of the League of Nations, which with our own voice, to the affliction and suffering brought upon us by the Italian aggressors, as well as to seek justice. But we were conscious of the need, first of all, to prepare for the Empress and our family, and for the many army commanders who had come out into exile with us, a place at which they could stay, and we therefore decided to go to Jerusalem. Hence, on Miyazia 25th, which is 3rd May, the British warship Enterprise arrived at Djibouti, and the captain informed us that we should prepare for embarkation. The reason why this warship had reached Djibouti so quickly was this. When we were fighting with the Italians at Mechu, they had destroyed, by aerial bombardment, our radio and telephone communications with Addis Ababa. Our ministers were therefore unable to get in touch with us for about a month, and as news from us was cut off and they were in difficulty over it, they contemplated sending the Empress and our family to Jerusalem, while they themselves
would go to western Ethiopia and set up the government at Gore. They held conversations with the British minister at Addis Ababa with a view to the British government sending a warship for the Empress, and the British government had already notified its willingness to do so. Some people, however, had gone so far as to spread it about that the reason why we were traveling on a British warship and had decided to come to Europe was that a friendly government had intervened in the matter and had proffered advice to this effect. This is a fairy tale, which is totally false, and there is no truth in it whatsoever. The main reason is simply, as we have expounded it above, also, since we were going to Jerusalem in a British mandated territory, no one can fail to see the propriety of traveling in a British warship. Those people who have expressed this idea may not be cognizant of the nature of British hospitality. On the morrow, Monday 26th, Miyazia 1928, which is 4th May 1936, at approximately 10 o'clock, which is 4 p.m. in the afternoon, we boarded the warship. Just before the ship was about to sail, the army commanders, who had continued resisting on the Ogaden front, i.e. Dejasmach Nasibu, Zamanel, Dejasmach Epta Mikael Yenadu, Dejasmach Amde Epta Slasi, Dejasmach Abeba Demtau, and Dejasmach Makonin in Dalakatcheu, came to us to convey a report on what they had done in the past and to receive orders on what they were to do in future. After submitting the report and receiving instructions for future action, they took their leave with great sorrow. Later, however, with the exception only of Dejasmach Epta Mikael Yenadu, they were to come on another boat. As the ship set out on her voyage, the government of the colony of French Somaliland offered us a farewell salute by firing guns and by having aircraft fly close to the ship in which we were sailing. Our heart was touched with joy at this gesture. Another five British warships, torpedo boats, followed at a distance the warship in which we were traveling. When we reached Port Said, after passing through the Suez Canal, our consul at Port Said and some other Ethiopians were in a boat with our greatly honored tricolor flag. As they rowed their boat close to the ship, we saw them wipe off their tears with their handkerchiefs, and thus that great grief of ours was reawakened, and we were deeply moved. Moreover, the ship was not stopping there, and there was thus much sadness in all our hearts at our passing by without being able to meet each other. On the fifth day, we reached the port of Haifa, and our ship anchored there. Other British warships were positioned in formation there to await our arrival. At a small distance from the ship in which we were, there was an Italian boat at anchor called the Carnero, and bedecked with flags. There was no doubt that they had done this with malice, thinking that we would be sad at seeing an Italian vessel now at our arrival as an exile from our own country. As we disembarked, the musical band of the Enterprise sounded the Ethiopian national anthem. Stepping on to the shore, we passed along the mustered ranks of the soldiers, giving us a respectful welcome. And here, likewise, they played the Ethiopian national anthem. Even the Jews and Arabs, who had been quarreling amongst themselves, forgot their dispute, and standing together, watched us with pleasure and respect. Thence we set out for Jerusalem, and when we reached the railway station there, the British government authorities received us with honor. First of all, we went to Golgotha, and after we paid homage at the tomb of our Lord, we went to the King David Hotel. On the following day, we went out to our monastery called Debre Genet. At Jerusalem, there is an extensive monastery which has been firmly established for a long time, and there live in it, entering into holy asylum, monks and nuns who have come from Ethiopia, having renounced the world. Their joy is great, for they live in this monastery, conversing in Amharic and celebrating Mass in Kittis. But now, when they heard of the entry into Addis Ababa, our capital city, of our aggressive enemy, and when they saw our arrival in a foreign country as an exile from our own. And in particular, when we told them that in the Italian war, many churches and many books had been burnt, and that many monks and priests, women and children, as well as the aged, had perished through poison gas and bombs, they began bursting into tears. Later on, in accordance with the plans which we had made when departing from Addis Ababa, we transmitted to the League of Nations at Geneva the following message in order to explain the reason why we had come here as an exile from our country. To the Secretary General of the League of Nations at Geneva, we would request you to make known on our behalf the following to member governments. In leaving for abroad to stop the total extermination of the Ethiopian people, we are resolved to devote ourselves in peace and in liberty to halting a war of aggression such as has never been seen or heard of in modern times, that is without parallel and is outside the character of and nature of man. We also wish to bring about protection from Italian evil deeds and the honoring of international obligations as a basis of Ethiopia's ancient independence and, indeed, the peace of the nations of the world. From the beginning, we have done everything possible to prevent peace being disturbed. We faithfully defended our country until Italy began to strike with poison gas like rain and until it became obvious that our resistance could not be continued. For if we did not resist, the result would only be the extermination of the Ethiopian people. And now we request that the League of Nations should not cease the strenuous efforts to have the covenant honored, and that it should not recognize claims of sovereignty of the territorial expansion through improper military force in breach of treaty obligations. Jerusalem, 11th Gembot, 1928, that is, 19th May, 1936, Haile Selassie I, Emperor. Chapter 49, Our Journey from Jerusalem to London. We had requested permission to go from Jerusalem to London, and after it had been granted, we arranged for the Empress and our family and the army commanders who had come with us to stay at Jerusalem. Accompanied by our sons, Crown Prince Marit Asmach Asfa Wilson and Makonnen, Duke of Harar, and our daughter Tsehai, as well as by Ras Kassa, who had been appointed by us commander of the Northern Army, we went from Jerusalem to Haifa on 15th Gembot, that is 23rd May. There we embarked in the British warship Cape Town and sailed to Gibraltar. At Gibraltar, we transferred to a passenger ship of the Orient Line, disembarked at the British seaport of Southampton, and from there traveled by train to London. At the railway station in London, the British public gave us a great welcome, and we then departed for the accommodation which had been prepared for us. The people assembled there demonstrated to us their participation in our grief, and we admired the tenderness and kindness of the British people. A few days later, we went to a meeting at which many people were assembled, and our daughter Tsehai did the same at a crowded assembly of women. There we laid bare the acts of cruelty which Italy had wrought upon the Christian and innocent Ethiopian people. When we now expounded to them in our own words the story of our tribulations, of which they had hitherto heard through news bulletins only, the British people, who do not love violence but seek true justice, all manifested to us their sympathy in our sadness. We had, of course, informed the League of Nations of the aggression carried out by Italy against Ethiopia, and we had accepted the conciliation proposals which the League, after due deliberation, had submitted. While Italy had persisted in her refusal to accept these, had crossed the borders and launched her attack. As laid down in Article 16 of the League Covenant, sanctions had been applied against Italy, but after the sanctions had continued for about 10 months, the matter was raised in the British Parliament. They debated the problem for a number of days, arguing that although sanctions had been applied against Italy, the latter had merely gone on intensifying her aggressive action against Ethiopia, who had not obtained any benefit from those sanctions. It would therefore be better to stop them rather than allow them to impede international trade in vain. Subsequently, many on behalf of the people argued that as Italy went on intensifying her aggression, it was necessary to add further sanctions. But whatever the circumstances, government opinion is known to prevail over the people's views. and we thus learnt of the decision to discontinue the sanctions. Chapter 50. Our journey to Geneva in quest of justice from the League of Nations. Before the Walwal attack, and even after it, we had not abandoned our firm faith in the League of Nations. Some people who saw this tried to instill doubts into our heart by arguing, if you had given up earlier on your faith in the League of Nations and had persisted preparing for war, all this calamity would not have come upon you. The faith which, from now onwards, you are reposing in the League of Nations will be in vain. But we were conscious that it was right to have a covenant honored even between two individuals, let alone a covenant of 52 nations. So we did not change our mind up to the last, other than adhering firmly to our intention not to diminish our faith in the League. That we had come here after leaving our country was to explain in person our tribulations to the League, in the firm conviction that the League would not fail to give us a fair judgment. When we were in London, we learnt that the League had arranged a meeting for June 26, 1936, that is, 19th Sunday, 1928, in order to discuss the dispute between Ethiopia and Italy, as well as some other smaller matters. We consequently decided to go to Geneva. When there were only some 8 days to go before the appointed day, some of our friends came and said to us, "It would be better if Your Majesty were not to go to Geneva." The reason being, if you yourself went and appeared before the assembly, and if, after your speech, you failed to secure justice, your grief would be the greater. Hence, it would be better if you sent envoys. Others again gave us friendly advice to this effect. At this time of your great troubles, unless you yourself appeared before the assembly and explained in your own words any of the matters concerned, or if you merely sent envoys, the problem would not appear sufficiently grave to the assembly. Hence, it would be better if you definitely attended. The reason why we had left our country, Ethiopia, and come here had not been in order to send envoys, but to explain in front of the League of Nations ourselves, and in our own words, the nature of the aggression committed against us. On 18th Sinai, 25th June, accompanied by His Highness Raskasa, Dejismach Nasibu, Blat Angeta Herui, Ato Walde Georges Walde Johannes, Ato Lorenzo de Izaz, and Ato Afrem Tewalda Madhin, we set out from London and went to Geneva by way of Paris, arriving there by train on the following morning. Subsequently, 23rd Sinai 1928, that is 30th June 1936, was the day fixed for us to speak our mind before the representatives of the 52 nations assembled there. When we went there, on the appointed day and stood by the lectern, the Italians, who had come there for news reporting, started to whistle continuously with the intention of obstructing our speech and rendering it inaudible. At this moment, the Romanian delegate M. Titulescu remarked to the president of the assembly, M. Van Zeeland, "For the sake of justice, silence these beasts." The president of the assembly, seeing the rude behavior of the Italians in front of so many international representatives, ordered the guards to expel the Italians by force. They then seized them and ejected them. After this, we read our speech in Amharic, and it was arranged that it should immediately be translated into French and English so that the whole assembly could understand it. The text was as follows. "Your Excellency, Mr. President, Your Excellency's envoys of the nations, I should have liked to speak to you in French, but as it is in the Amharic language alone that I am able to speak my mind from my heart and with all the force of my spirit, I would beg the forgiveness of the General Assembly of the League of Nations for not speaking in French. I, Haile Selassie I, Emperor of Ethiopia, am present here today to ask for the impartial justice due to my people and for the help which 52 nations had undertaken to extend to it when they affirmed 8 months ago that a war of aggression in violation of international law was being waged against Ethiopia. There is no man other than the Emperor to present the appeal of the Ethiopian people to these 52 nations. Perhaps this is the first time that a king or president appears before this assembly and addresses it. But it is truly only today that violence of this kind is seen being committed against a people which is now falling victim to the aggressor. Furthermore, there has not been since a previous example of a government that has set out to extinguish methodically and by means of cruelty the entire stock of another people, in transgression of a covenant which it has honorably and publicly entered into in form of a treaty concluded with the nations of the world, to wit that one government was not to deprive another of its country by means of war, and that it was not to exterminate innocent human beings by powerful and toxic poison gas. The reason that I, as Emperor of Ethiopia, have come to Geneva after having fought myself as Commander-in-Chief of my army is to fulfill this highest duty of mine and to defend the Ethiopian people struggling to preserve its independence, which has endured for many thousands of years. I pray to God that he may keep the nations of the world from the torment that has been inflicted upon my people and from the nauseating things of which these chiefs who have followed me here have been witnesses and which have indeed happened to themselves. I shall explain in detail to the representatives of the nations assembled in Geneva, who are responsible for the lives of many millions of men, women, and children, about the mortal danger awaiting these creatures and the fate which has overwhelmed Ethiopia. It is not only upon Ethiopian soldiers that the Italian government has made war. Above all, it has struck at peaceful people far removed from the battlefield by killing them with terror raids and exterminating them altogether. At the beginning of the war, in 1928, that is 1935, Italian airplanes launched tear gas bombs upon my armies. These bombs did not harm them very greatly, as the soldiers knew, when these bombs were being dropped, how to scatter until the wind had disposed of the gas. After this, the Italian airplanes began to drop Yiparite gas. Casks containing Yiparite fell upon the Ethiopian army, but the harm which this Yiparite gas caused was not considerable. The reason for this was that there were only a few soldiers whom the Yiparite liquid affected, and when the cask fell upon the ground, both the soldiers and the population realized that they contained poison. When Ethiopian troops had encircled Makale, the Italian army commander-in-chief had good reason to feel anxiety about the possible dissolution of the Italian army and, therefore, directed the dropping of Yiparite in a different manner. It is now my duty to reveal this action to the world. A mechanism spraying Yiparite liquid was installed in the aircraft, and it was arranged that a fine rain bringing death should descend over vast tracts of country. At one time, 9, 15, or 18 Italian airplanes were going to and fro, bringing down an unceasing rain of Yiparite. From the end of 1928, which is to say late January 1936, onwards, this death-dealing rain descended uninterruptedly upon our soldiers, upon women, children, cattle, streams, stagnant waters, as well as pastures. The Italian army commander made the airplanes repeat this work of theirs in order to extinguish completely all living creatures and to turn into poison the waters and the grazing grounds. He made this the principal means of warfare. This work of cruelty, carried out with some finesse, annihilated people in places far removed from the battlefield and made their country into a desert. The plan was to spread terror and death over the greater part of Ethiopia. This most deplorable scheme was eventually accomplished. Man and beast perished completely. The deadly downpour that descended from the aircraft made anyone who touched it fly with torment. Those who drank the water upon which this poisonous rain had settled, or ate the food which the poison had touched, died in dreadful agony. The people who died as a result of the Italian Yiparite must be reckoned in many thousands. It was to make known to the civilized world the torment inflicted upon the Ethiopian people that I decided to come to Geneva. There is none better qualified than myself and these men who were in the war with me to provide the League of Nations with this indisputable testimony. If Europe reckons this matter to be an accomplished fact, then it is proper to consider this fate which awaits it and which is bound to come upon it. The appeal which might envoys presented to the League of Nations when this whole tribulation descended upon my army and my people had remained without obtaining any reply. My witness and afflictions suffered by Ethiopia, I have resolved to come myself to describe the criminal acts perpetrated against my people. It is not necessary. It is to remind the General Assembly of the League of Nations meeting here today of what has happened to Ethiopia over this period of time. For the past 20 years, when working first as Crown Prince and Regent of the Ethiopian realm, and later as Emperor and leader of my people, I have not ceased striving to obtain for my country the benefits of modern civilization and, in particular, to establish relations of good neighborliness with adjacent governments. With Italy especially, I concluded a treaty of friendship in 1920, that is to say 1928, which prohibited the resort to war under any circumstances whatever, and which provided for any dispute arising between the two governments to be settled amicably and by arbitration, a procedure which the civilized nations of the world have made the basis for the peace of their peoples. In the declaration which the Committee of 13 Governments presented on 25th Meskerem 1928, that is to say 6th October 1935, it told me expressly that it was aware of the efforts I had made. The text was as follows. The nations had considered that, by her entry into the League, and by affording her new confidence that her territorial integrity would not be impaired and her independence not be destroyed, Ethiopia would attain a higher level of civilization than she possessed now. In present day Ethiopia, there does not appear to be the lack of security and the condition of lawlessness that could still be seen in 1915, which is to say 1923. In fact, the country has become more united than before, and the authority of the central government is more respected than in the past. If the Italian government had not created all sorts of trouble for me by pushing some men to raise up revolts in Ethiopia and by giving arms to the rebels, the work I have been doing for my people would have been even more beneficial and have shown better results. The Rome government, as indeed it has now openly admitted, has been preparing unceasingly plans to take Ethiopia by means of war. Thus, all the treaties with me which it had signed were not sincere. The fact that it had signed this treaty of friendship in particular was intended to serve the purpose of concealing its real plans. The Italian government has confirmed its preparations for the past 14 years to undertake what it has now obtained by force. Therefore, it is possible to say that it was doing things to undermine the confidence of the world when it aided and supported the admission of Ethiopia to the League of Nations in 1915, which is to say 1923, when it concluded that treaty of friendship in 1920. The Ethiopian government however, believed to find in all these treaties concluded with great solemnity fresh confidence that it was possible to accomplish the work it had initiated with all its heart and strength to lead the country on a peaceful path towards civilization. The Wall conflict, which occurred in Hadar 1927, that is to say December 1934, was felt by me like a sudden flash of lightning descended from the sky. But it was obvious that Italy wished this quarrel to take place. I did not delay informing the League of Nations of this incident. I requested that the matter be looked at according to the text laid down in the 1920, that is to say 1928 treaty, on the basis of the League's Ration de Etre, in accord with the arbitration provisions and all these various procedures. But it was Ethiopia's misfortune that it appeared absolutely essential to some governments to obtain Italy's friendship by whatever means on the grounds of the situation in Europe. The price paid for the Italian government's coercive demands was to hand over Ethiopia's independence. This secretly contrived agreement, rather than the obligations into which the nations of the world had entered under the League Covenant, became an awful burden for all the affairs of Ethiopia that arose at that time. On these grounds, Ethiopia and the whole world have experienced great difficulties over this calamity, and to this day, these problems persist. This setting aside of the covenant of the League, then occurring for the first time, has not remained a unique occasion. The Rome government, feeling reinforced in the policy adopted against Ethiopia, initiated preparations for war, just in case the pressure that began to be exerted upon Ethiopia turned out to be insufficient to induce Ethiopian people to accept Italian rule. Hence, it was to Italy's advantage to delay matters. Things were dragged out by many kinds of stratagems and in various ways, so that the arbitrators who had been chosen for conciliation were unable to start their task. All sorts of obstacles were devised to prevent the work of the arbitrators being completed. Some governments sought to prohibit the selection of arbitrators from among their nationals. Once the arbitration procedure had been set up, the arbitrators were subjected to pressure to bring in a verdict favorable to Italy. However, all this effort was in vain. The arbitrators, two of whom were Italians, issued a unanimous judgment to the effect that neither in the Walwal incident nor in any subsequent one was there anything to make Ethiopia responsible before the Committee of Nations. After this verdict had been given, the Ethiopian government was truly confident in supposing that this would usher in a new era of friendship with Italy. I stretched out my hand to the Rome government in all sincerity. The Committee of 13 Nations informed the General Assembly in the report rendered at its meeting on 25th Mescaram 1928, that is 6th October 1935, of the details of the entire story in its various stages, beginning with Hadar 1927, that is December 1934, until 23rd Mescaram 1928, that is 4th October 1935. From the conclusions reached in this report, I would now only remind you of the text in paragraph 24, 25, and 26. It was on 29th Nahase 1927, that is 4th September 1935, that the Italian memorandum was handed to the council, but the Ethiopian memorandum, its first appeal, is dated 5th Tahasus 1927, that is 14th December 1934. Between these two dates, the Italian government insisted that the matter should only be determined according to the wording laid down in the 1920, that is to say 1928, treaty between Ethiopia and Italy, meaning to prevent the problem coming before the council. Throughout this time, Italian soldiers were continually being dispatched in the direction of East Africa. The Italian government, concealing its secret intentions, informed the council that the reason for the dispatch of troops was that they were needed for defense, as Ethiopian government, by its military preparations, was causing anxiety to the Italian colonies in the area. The Ethiopian government repeatedly drew attention to the fact that, quite to the contrary, the Italian government left no doubt as to their hostile intentions, as can indeed be seen from the official speeches delivered in Italy. From the beginning of the dispute, the Ethiopian government has sought to settle the matter by peaceful means. It has requested that the problem be looked into under the provisions of the League's covenant. As, however, the Italian government desired that the matter be looked at only under the procedures laid down in the Italo-Ethiopian Treaty of 1920, that is to say 1928, the Ethiopian government accepted this. The latter also declared that, even if the arbitrators failed to find in its favor, it would carry out the conditions of the verdict with goodwill. When Italy remained adamant that she would not allow the arbitrators to look into the question of the ownership of Walwal, Ethiopia accepted this as well. The Ethiopian government requested the council to send to the country neutrals who should investigate this matter, and it also declared its preparedness to accept any inquiry upon which the council may wish to decide. The Italian government, on its part, presented to the council Once the Wall Wall problem had been settled by arbitration, a detailed memorandum to request the freedom to be able to do what it pleased. It asserted that there was nothing appropriate laid down in the League's covenant to settle the whole problem concerning Ethiopia. It further announced that, since this matter was of vital interest to Italy and was a primary requirement for its own security, Italy would be neglecting its most elementary duty unless it entirely removed its confidence from Ethiopia and obtained full freedom to carry out what was necessary to safeguard its own interest and to protect its colonies. These then are the terms of the report which the Committee of 13 Nations presented. The Council and the General Assembly announced unitedly and openly that the Italian government was the aggressor and was in breach of the League's covenant. I have unceasingly made it known time and time again that I was not seeking to wage the war that was being imposed upon me, that I was fighting was solely to prevent my people's liberty and Ethiopia's territorial integrity being affected. I was additionally defending in this war the cause of all small nations who are neighbors of powerful states, lest such a neighbor should be able to take their country by force. In the month of Tekemt 1928, that is October 1935, the 52 nations who are listening to me today gave me the following promise: the aggressor will not prevail. We shall see that the provisions of the covenant are implemented so that a lawful government shall be firmly supported and that the perpetrator of force transgressing the law shall be destroyed. I would remind the nations not to forget this their policy, for it is I who have followed the policy which the 52 nations have pursued these last 8 months, in which I manifested my faith and upon which I directed my people to defend themselves against a government that had been condemned of aggression by the whole world. Although my war equipment was so much less than the aggressors, and although I possessed no airplanes, artillery, other weapons whatsoever, or indeed hospital services for the wounded, my hope rested upon the covenant of the League. I thought it impossible that 52 nations, among whom were some of the mightiest in the world, could be defeated by one sole aggressor government. Reposing my trust in the efficacy of treaties, exactly as happened to some small nations in Europe, I had made no preparations for war. When the danger became more pressing and the responsibility towards my people irked my conscience, I tried to obtain arms throughout 1928, that is October 1935, May 1936. Many governments prohibited the export of arms, intending to prevent me from obtaining any. The Italian government, however, was able to transport through the Suez Canal weapons, munitions, and troops uninterruptedly and without anyone stopping them. On Meskerem 23rd, that is 4th October, the Italian army invaded my country, and only a few hours after that did I issue a proclamation of mobilization. In the desire to live by maintaining peace, I directed my troops to fall back some 30 kilometers from the frontiers in order not to provoke a conflict by whatever pretext, exactly as an important nation had done when war was about to break out at the time of the Great War. After that was continued with great violence, exactly as I have explained to the Council. In this struggle of unequal rivalry between a government which had at its disposal a people of 42 million inhabitants, which was able to obtain all the necessary weapons and resources, and which possessed all the technical knowledge to make arms of various kinds to extinguish human life, and, on the other hand, a small people of 12 million inhabitants, which lived by trusting only impartial justice and the covenant of the League of Nations, and which possessed neither arms nor money. In this unequal war, you yourselves can well assess that there has not been any real help for the Ethiopian government. Even after the Rome government had been condemned of having violated the League's covenant, and after the nations had declared that they would resist the aggressor's triumph, is it that every single government in the League has considered the war of aggression exactly as if it had been waged against itself as an individual member, as the signature which is appended to Article 17 of the League's Covenant required it to do. I had placed all my hopes in the dutiful fulfillment of these obligations. My hopes had obtained support from the declarations made in the League that the aggressor would not gain a reward and that force would be defeated by the law. In the month of Tejasas, 1928, which is December 1935, the Council made it clearly known that it shared the view of many hundreds of millions of people in the whole world who opposed the plan which had been presented for the partition of Ethiopia. It has been said many times, this conflict which has arisen is not only the conflict of Ethiopia and Italy, but it is the conflict of the Italian government and the League of Nations. This is why I myself and my people replied that I would not accept all the proposals which the Italians had submitted to me, which were for my own benefit, but which would undermine the covenant of the League of Nations that I had adopted. The position of resistance was additionally also for the cause of small nations exposed to aggression. And where have all the promises of the support that were given to me got to? Ever since Tejasas, 1928, that is December 1935, I had noted with much distress that three governments were regarding as entirely valueless the obligations under which they had entered into the League Covenant. The relationship which they had with Italy made them unwilling to accept anything to stop the work of aggression which Italy had undertaken. Moreover, it was the position of some governments that made me very dejected. These governments, while unceasingly declaring the faith which they reposed in the League of Nations, were equally unceasingly striving to prevent the law of the League being carried out. Some governments, when some sound proposal was tabled that would at once arrest the work of the aggressor, were causing delay with many pretexts so that the matters should not come up for discussion, let alone be carried out. The secret agreements made in the month of Ter, which is 1927, which is early January 1935, where they intended to presage this work of obstruction. The Ethiopian government did not expect other governments whose direct interests were not involved to shed their soldiers' blood for the defense of the League's covenant. What the warriors of Ethiopia did expect was merely the means they required for their defense. I had therefore asked many times to obtain the funds necessary for the purchase of arms. I was denied this assistance. What then is the explanation of the wording of Article 16 in the League's Covenant, or indeed of the solemn promise made that the nations would stand together and, by mutual assistance, prevent the extinction of security? Many difficulties have been brought up to prevent the transport of arms intended for Ethiopia by the Djibouti-Addis Ababa Railway, and equally to stop the entry by that route of equipment at the required time that would be of service to the Ethiopian government. Yet for the present, this is the principal route of transportation of supplies and arms for the Italian army which has entered Ethiopia illicitly. Even the rules of neutrality should prohibit the loading of equipment of this kind to reach the Italian forces at the places where they are at present. This being so, under the wording of Article 16 of the Covenant of the League of Nations, it is improper for the neutrality clauses to be waived in this case, for all governments who are League members have to suspend their neutrality if one government attacks another, as it is incumbent upon them to offer help not to the aggressor but to the victim of the attack. In this manner, has the covenant been observed in the past? And is it possible to say that it is being respected today? Now, latterly, some great nations who have considerable influence in the League have announced in their parliaments that, since the Italian aggressor had managed to seize part of the Ethiopian territory, there was no need now to continue the preventative measures in the financial sphere that had been set up against Italy. This is the position in which the General Assembly of the League finds itself today as it meets to examine, at the request of the Argentine government, the situation brought about by the Italian aggressor. The issue which is today before the League of Nations General Assembly is not merely to settle what Italy has done by way of aggression. I would assert that it is something that touches upon all governments of the world. This is a problem of the duty of governments to assist each other to establish world security, what is called collective security, It is a question of the very life of the League of Nations, of the trust which the nations of the world can properly repose in treaties they have concluded, of the value attached to promises which the small nations have received as regards the inviolability of their territorial integrity and independence, so that these values be respected and properly esteemed. It is to assess whether the principle of the equality of nations is to be confirmed, or whether the small states will have to accept subjection to the powerful ones. In brief, it is not only Ethiopia that is at stake, but the decent way of life of the peoples of the world who have been thus affected and wronged. The signatures appended to a treaty, is it that they attain their value only in so far as they are of use to the signatories in the pursuit of their personal, direct, and immediate interests? Subtle comparisons cannot change the main problem or lead the discussion in another direction. It is with sincerity of heart that I submit these reflections to the General Assembly of the League. Apart from the Kingdom of God, there is no human government that possesses greater merit than any other. But on this earth, when a powerful government sets out in the belief that it is right to exterminate another nation against which no offense has been proved, then the hour comes for the injured party to bring the wrongs it has suffered before the League of Nations. God in history will observe as witnesses the judgment you will give. At a time when my people is close to extinction, when the help of the League may yet be able to save it from that fate, it is proper that I should be permitted to speak the truth without holding back anything, without reticence, and without prevarication. I hear it being asserted that the sanctions which have hitherto been applied and which have remained inadequate have not produced the expected result. It was well known that the sanctions which were intentionally devised to be insufficient and which were also improperly applied could not at any time and in any circumstance stop the aggressor. This has caused our failure to stop the aggressor. But it is not right to say that it was impossible. Ethiopia had previously asked to be given financial aid. She is asking for it now. Was this matter incapable of implementation? Yet the League of Nations had given financial assistance and even in peacetime to other governments who now refuse to apply sanctions against the aggressor, despite the fact that the Italian government had employed cruel means of warfare and had many times and repeatedly transgressed all international laws. I note with a very sad heart that a plan is now being devised to lift sanctions. Is this intended action not tantamount to abandoning Ethiopia and saying, let the aggressor government do to her what it pleases? Does not this initiative, coming as it does just before I appear before the League's General Assembly, with this great effort in the defense of my people, cut off one of Ethiopia's last chances of obtaining help and guarantees from the governments who are members of the League? Is it an objective of this kind which the League and its members may confidently expect from the support of the great powers who possess the means to be leaders of the League's actions? If by the acts of aggression carried out by Italy things have come to such a pass, will the governments who are members of the League have to subordinate their own wishes to the precedent of brute force? Proposals are assuredly to come before the General Assembly of the League with a view to improving the League covenant and rendering more effective the guarantees of mutual aid. But is it really necessary to change the covenant, unless those who have signed the covenant have the will to observe its previous provisions in full? What guarantees are there that the covenant, even if changed, will be safeguarded? It is the determination of the nations of the world that is defective, and not the covenant of the League. In the name of the Ethiopian people, which is a member of the League of Nations, I request the Assembly that everything necessary be carried out to have the covenant respected. I now renew once more the protest which I have previously submitted on the grounds of the transgression of treaties to the detriment of the Ethiopian people and on account of the violence perpetrated against it. I declare before the world that the Emperor of Ethiopia, the Ethiopian government, and the people will not accept anything done to them by force. I further declare that they will do everything in their power to see international order triumph, to have the League covenant respected, and to have the authority and the territory which is theirs restored to them. I ask the 52 nations who have given a promise to the Ethiopian people that they would come to their aid at the time of the aggression against them in order to prevent the aggressor from defeating them. I ask these 52 nations for their support by upholding their promise. What are you willing to do for Ethiopia? You great powers who have promised to give guarantees of collective security, let small nations be extinguished, and the fate which has overtaken Ethiopia should befall them as well. Have you considered what kind of assistance to provide so that Ethiopia's liberty shall not be destroyed and her territorial integrity shall be respected? You representatives of the world assembled here, I have come to you to Geneva to carry out the saddest duty that has befallen an emperor. What answer am I to take back to my people?